So, good morning everybody. Welcome back to the lecture series on polymer science and processing. In this week's lecture, we want to talk about polymers in solution, or thermodynamics of polymer solutions if you want. And before we dig into this, let me briefly recapitulate what we learned last week. We looked at special cases of polymer materials, especially polymer networks, and then we try to see how the cross-linking affects the chain structure. And we saw that in contrast to a non-crossing polymer that simply dissolves, a loosely crossing polymer swells up and then forms a polymer gel, most famously known as hydrogels, for example, in diapers and so. And if we then continue to increase the cross-linking density, eventually our material will become harder and harder and more resistant to mechanical impacts and so on. And at the end of the day, if you have a very high cross-linking density, it doesn't swell at all, but really protects the interior from chemical attacks because the solvent cannot enter this very tightly cross-linked polymer network. That was the first part, and then in the second part, we looked at the influence of chain architectures when we have two polymer chains linked together, if you want. So this were block copolymers. And then we saw that there's fairly interesting phenomena that arise from this inabilities of polymers to mix and then phase separate. So now last week's lecture, I said that you should simply believe me that polymers do not mix well. Now, in contrast to Donald Trump in the US election, believing is maybe not really the right thing to do, but we should really look at the truth and count. And this is exactly what we want to do. So in this case, we now today want to reveal why polymers do not mix well by counting the numbers of microstates such polymers can adapt. And now you will maybe not understand what this means, but I will explain this to you in a second. Okay, so with this, we can directly dig in. What we want to do is first look at a single polymer chain in solution. And once we understand this, we can then translate to what happens with many polymer chains in solution, and this will give us, at the end of the day, the free energy of mixing, and this will tell us why polymers do not mix as well as monomers. But before going there, let's look at a single polymer chain in solution. Now, if you close your eyes or think about how you would picture a polymer chain, or how long a polymer chain would be in solution, then there's of course different ways on how we can look at such a polymer chain. And in order to do this, we kind of need to find a parameter. We need to define parameters that we can use to describe a polymer chain in solution. So we know that a polymer chain consists of many monomer chains that are linked, chemically linked together. And I already gave you this analogy of a spaghetti. Now this is something that we can still keep in mind. So our polymer chain that actually looks like this, kind of many carbon atoms, we can simply approximate as a long kind of chain that typically curls around in space like a polymer chain. And now our question is, how can we characterize this? Well, let's say, analyze. So, I mean, if we ask ourselves how large is the polymer, maybe the simplest thing we can do is look at the polymer chain, take the two ends, and then stretch them out until you cannot stretch anymore, and this will give us the contour length of the polymer. We typically denote this capital L, and this is the fully stretched chain. And that's of course very simple to calculate. We have all our monomers that are now chained together completely. We ignore bond angles and so on, and then simply say that L is the number of monomers times small l, which is the length of the individual monomer. Okay, so this is kind of a measure, of course, how big the polymer is. But now the problem is this will more characterize hard spaghettis before you put them in water, no? Fully extended. Now we all know that a spaghetti in water will look significantly more compressed because it becomes flexible and then starts to form a coil, and the same is true for the polymers. And in order to kind of analyze the dimensions of this polymer in solution when it's in this coiled form, we can take the two ends here and then look at the distance between the both of these ends. So this is what is known as the end-to-end distance. So this is the distance between the two chains. But of course, now we can take a snapshot at each point in time, and we get an end-to-end distance. But since the polymer can move, it undergoes Brownian motion, all the different bond segments can rotate, so the whole thing is dynamic and changes all the time. So it's not a very useful quantity to have a single snapshot and tell that should give us the dimensions of the polymer, because at any given time, this can be very close together or very far away. So a better way of analyzing or giving a number to a polymer is to average this end-to-end distance over time. And how we can assign this is the so-called root mean square or RMS end-to-end distance. And this is simply the time average of the end distance, and in order to avoid negative values, we just count the absolute values, we square it, and then take the square root out of this. So this gives us an average distance of the two polymer ends as they kind of rotate in solution. And this is, of course, a meaningful quantity because it gives us a dimension of this coil as it moves. But then you could say, well, there's also polymers that are not linear, but they may be hyperbranched, they may be maybe a ring, and they simply wouldn't have a single end, or simply have branching points. And in this case, you can go away from this strict definition of ends and simply say we take the radius of gyration, which is the distance of a single polymer segment to the center of mass. So let me just, so this would also be the RMS, root mean square, radius of gyration. In German, this would be their Trägheitsradius. And this is typically denoted S. And again, we take the square and then the root again to make sure that we don't have any negative values. And this also applies to, let's say, hyperbranched polymers or a ring-like polymer, because you can define the center of gravity and then take this distance as here. Good, okay, so you see there's different ways on how to look at the polymers, but since we already assume from our spaghetti model that it coils, these kind of quantities are somewhat meaningful. And now the question is, how can we calculate this? And I will give you a very simple model that gives us the dimensions overall wide, and then we can discuss on the PowerPoint slides a little bit more, like where the difficulties are and what we are missing in this model and how we can manipulate this. But what we're doing is a very simple random flight. And we completely ignore any bond angles. Okay, so of course, we know that typical polymer chains, when they consist of hydrocarbon chains or CCC bonds in the backbone, they will have a tetrahedral bond angle because the carbon is sp3 hybridized. But now, for the sake of simplicity, we simply ignore this. And what we say is that we start at the origin of a coordinate system, and now we simply add chains or monomer units with a length small l in random directions. So we start with one, then we do a second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and so on. And this will give us then the total polymer chain. And again, where is it? We assign the end-to-end distance here as R, very similar to our spaghetti model. And then we calculate. So we have the radius, the end-to-end distance R, this vector, and we simply denote this as the sum of all the small vectors L from 1 to n. This will be our polymer. And now, as you see, we don't want to have, this is an I, we don't want to have this end-to-end distance, but we need to square it. So this is what we're going to do. R squared, and R squared will then be Li squared. And now we need to be careful. If we square this, we need to factor in not only the like terms, but also the unlike terms, like in a binomial formula. So this would be the sum of Li squared, that's already here, plus 2 times Li Lj, where I is not equal to j. Notice this is a squared plus 2ab plus b squared. This is the 2ab here. And now we can take advantage of our simplified model, because if all bond angles are equally likely, then in average they will have an angle of 90 degrees. Now they run from 0, which would be this one, to or this one to 180 degrees, where it flips. And of course, on average, they point 90 degrees. And that means that this term here, average over time, Lj, is 0, because the dot product of two vectors that are in an angle of 90 degrees is 0. And that is because the dot product is L1 times L2 is connected to the cosine of the angle. And the cosine at 90 degrees is 0, and this is why this drops to 0. And now our calculation is already over, so if we take this root mean square roughness, so we average over time. First, we don't take the square, the root mean square. This becomes n times L. L squared. And if we now take our root mean square of this time average, then we see it comes out as n to the power of 1/2 times L. So here is an L. Like this. Now, super simple calculation, a lot of approximations, but what we see here is that suddenly, while the contour length, so if you stretch out the chain completely, you see this is proportional to n. The more monomers you have, the longer your polymer chain. But now in this more realistic random coil geometry, we see that the dimensions of the polymer chain scale with the square root of R. And this is really important. Or in short, polymer chains are significantly more compressed when they coil up as compared to the stretched out versions. Let's just make a very quick example to see what we can expect. We take a random polymer, let's say polyethylene, that has an N of 10,000. So 10,000 monomer units connected. It's maybe a small polyethylene, but still whatever, significant. And we assume that the length of the monomer is 0.3 nanometers. And we can justify this because a CC bond is approximately 150 picometers, so 0.15 nanometers. And in the repeat unit of the polymer, we have 2 CC bonds in the back unit, so this would be approximately times 2, again ignoring the tetrahedral angle. So round about 0.2 to 0.3. So now if we do this, then we see that the contour length L would equal n times L, so 10,000 times 0.3 would be 3,000 nanometers or 3 micrometers if you stretch it out completely. But now if you put it in solution and you let, if you want the spaghetti boil to become soft, then we get for our more accurate dimension the square root of 10,000 is 100, and 100 times 0.3 is 30. So you see that instead of 3 micrometers, our polymer chain dimensions is actually only 30 nanometers in solution. So there you see that the square root really, because the numbers are large, makes a big difference for the dimensions. Okay, so this is a very simplified picture just to give you an idea on how we can kind of look at the polymer. And now I go back to the screen, show you exactly the same thing that I just showed you on the screen. This is what we just calculated. So you see this is what comes out. And of course you can do this much more realistically if you do a real 3D random walk statistics. So then you not only get the average distance, so this root mean square end-to-end distance, but you also get the probability distributions. Okay, this is not something I want to go through with you because the math takes quite some time to derive. But at the end of the day, you arrive something like this. So a probability, capital W, of finding the end of a polymer at a certain point x, y, z, so somewhere in space, for example, just here, is given by this formula. And you see this nl squared also pops up in this exponent. So you see if you average this over time, it comes out exactly the same. But you can also look at the probability of finding the end at a certain distance from the center. So instead of asking whether it's here, it doesn't really matter where it is, as long as the r stays the same. So you kind of integrate over the shell of a sphere, and then you get this additional volume of the shell with a thickness dr term here. Okay, so long story short, what comes out if you look at these two, then you see that the probability of finding the polymer end at a certain distance has its maximum exactly where we calculated it. So our average is correct, but it of course has a distribution. Okay, and the probability of finding the polymer at a certain point, somewhat surprisingly, is still highest right at the center. But this is because of course you have much more points on shells the further out you move. And I'm just showing this to you because we will need to use this formula eventually when we derive an equation to describe rubber elasticity in one of the future lectures. Okay, so now I said, of course, we are cheating, and in reality, we have fixed bond angles. So now this angle here is completely fixed. And you can also derive equations for this, and you see now the same thing for fixed angles gives you the same overall function, but you have this additional term where these angles pop up. And then if you assume that a typical bond angle in a tetrahedron is around about 110 degrees, then the cosine of this is minus 1/2, so you can plug this in, and you see that by accounting for bond angles, you get this additional factor of a square root of 2, so the polymer coil slightly increases in dimensions when you fix the bond angles. But nevertheless, this relation of the square root of the chain length is still valid. Okay, so as a quick summary for this simplified picture of the polymer configurations or conformations in solution is polymers adopt a random coil geometry, very clearly in analogy to our spaghetti model, and we see that the end-to-end distance in this coil is significantly smaller than what we would expect from the contour length. All right, so now to the big question. Why do polymers not mix so well? Why did we assume last week, or why did I tell you to believe me, that they phase separate? And no, I already showed you kind of arguments why this is true, because you've seen electron microscopy images of such phase separated polymers. And this brings us to this question, how we picture now many polymers in a solution in the liquid state, or how can we describe the thermodynamics of mixing? And in order to do this, I will clear up some space. And you can already at home think for yourself what the proper criterion would be to ask, or which question we need to ask to thermodynamically describe whether to polymers or to monomers or whatever mixes or not. So what's kind of the yardstick we need to apply? So for the free energy of mixing, of course, you already all know the answer, being good scientists or engineers. What we need to ask, if something mixes, we look at the free energy, and the free energy is delta G mixing of the mixing process, which is simply G, let me denote this 1, 2 for the mixed state, now where two different materials are mixed, minus G1 plus G2, so this is the initial states of only component 1 and only component 2. And if we want the system to mix, what we need to find or need to see is whether or not this free energy is below 0. Okay, so this will be our yardstick, and this will be pretty much everything that we will do for the rest of this lecture. Now we of course need to make this a little bit more defined. Delta G is delta H mixing minus T delta S mixing, and again, for it to mix, it requires to be smaller than 0. Okay, this is kind of clear textbook knowledge. Now let's first have a very intuitive picture on what we would assume or what is going on here. So let's start with the entropy term. Entropy in a mixture is generally higher than in pure states because there's just more potential ways on how to mix the system, or maybe kind of easily speaking, it's more disordered. And I will come to this classification of entropy in a second. So this entropy term by intuition will be positive. So you promote entropy by mixing things up. And this enthalpy term here is not so easy. There we can just say it depends. And it depends on the interactions. Depends on interactions. So this term will tell us whether a polymer chain would like to be surrounded by other polymer chains, in which case it doesn't mix, or whether it would prefer to be surrounded by solvent molecules, in which case it mixes. So then we can already, from this understanding, we can intuitively put up three different pictures in a good solvent. When the polymer likes to be surrounded by solvents, our random coil will increase in dimensions simply because all the solvent needs to find a place around the polymer chain. So in a good solvent, we will get swelling. While in a bad solvent, the polymer chain collapses because it just wants to be surrounded by itself, and all the solvent molecules stay outside. And there we see that the polymer chain collapses. And in between, there must be a state where the polymer is equally or likes to be surrounded by polymer chains and by monomer or by solvent molecules equally well. And in this case, it swells a little bit because it's surrounded by monomers a little bit, but also not too much because it likes to be surrounded by itself as well. And in this case, we speak of put this in here, we speak of so-called theta conditions. And in this case, in these theta conditions, if we find a solvent mixture that creates the scenario that is equally likely to be surrounded by polymer chain segments or by solvents, then we measure ideal polymer dimensions. And then it comes out to exactly what I discussed before on the blackboard, that we have this RMS, end-to-end distance, will be n to the power of 1/2 times L. So this is really kind of, you make up for non-idealities by simply equalizing them. And then we talk about the swelling ratio. In this case, the swelling ratio alpha is 1. So no swelling. Here alpha is larger than 1, and here alpha is smaller than 1, so the polymer is collapsed. And this, of course, as I said, is an important consideration because we get dimensions as we would calculate them on paper. Okay, so this is kind of just an intuitive picture, and now what we want to do is really put numbers to this. And in order to put numbers to this, I want to first introduce a little bit more what entropy is. So typically what we would say, what is entropy? Here is some pictures randomly taken from my team members' offices. One would probably say that this desk here is fairly tidy, so we would say it has a low entropy. But this desk here is not very tidy. You know, there's multiple coffee mugs and bottles and paper and much more paper here and so on. So we would say this has a high entropy. Because commonly, we kind of use entropy as a yardstick of disorder. But I would argue this is actually a common mistake, and entropy does not so much describe order, but the numbers of microstates. So a more proper way of defining entropy is the numbers of available microstates, and this is the way on how to reach a certain system. And in order to show this to you a little bit more clearly, Reza, maybe you can just help me by zooming in a little bit. I want to show you a textbook to describe this a little bit more. So this is something that currently my daughter is studying, statistical physics for babies, and this gives us already in a very simplified picture an impression on what's going on. So they count on why it's more likely to have a gas equally mixed in two chambers and not kind of residing here, which is kind of the same as an entropy of mixing. So, and what they say is rarely all the balls are on the same page, and usually we find them like this, kind of equally distributed because this is the equilibrium state. And now they also give kind of an argument why by assigning the balls a different color, and now they count. And they say when all the balls are here, there's only one possible state. When one ball is here, we have 6 possible states. When 2 balls are on the right side, we have, how much is that, 15 possible states. And when there's 3 balls on both sides of the chamber, then there's 20 ways for each for this permutation. And they say that is why we used to see this more often. And now, here it comes, physicists call the numbers of different combinations entropy. So this has a low entropy, this has a high entropy. So you see, even for babies, it's very clear that we need to count. And now what we're going to do is exactly the same thing as this book proposes. We're going to count the numbers of microstates. Okay? And of course, we are not babies anymore, so we can also put a number on this counting to really quantify the entropy. Is it Aligned again, perfect. And this is given by the famous Boltzmann equation. So the Boltzmann equation links the entropy S with the numbers of microstates omega. And K is the Boltzmann constant, which is the proportionality factor that kind of levels this. Okay, so really what Boltzmann did here is to give us a way on how we can literally count entropy. And because this is such a great contribution, you see this is the tombstone of Ludwig Boltzmann, I think in Vienna, and you see it was important enough to dominate his tombstone after his death. Okay, so now using Boltzmann's equation, we can get a better measure or better understanding on why we would say this has a higher entropy compared to this disk. And this is simply because there's more ways on how to arrange the system. Now you can easily imagine there's like 10 papers here and I can shuffle around the papers, put this one here and this one there, and you will not notice. This is the definition of a microchain. So I manipulate the system, and when you come in again, you can macroscopically, the desk will look exactly the same. Now only in very minute details will it change. And this is what we're going to do as well. So you can flip a lot of things here. Now you can maybe shift around the bottles, put the spoon in here or in there. You can, whatever, twist or swap these coffee mugs and the stuff here. Here is not so much that you can actually manipulate at the system because there's not so many objects on the desk. So, I mean, the outcome is the same. We would say this has a higher entropy, but it's not really related to the disorder, but to the numbers of ways we can manipulate the system. And surprisingly, and this is really not something I want to go into detail, but for those of you that are interested, together with Michael Engel and Robin Klopp-Taylor, we are teaching a course on self-organization processes where we treat such systems in much more detail, and Michael Engel will give you a very thorough and in-depth analysis of these phenomena. But yet, let me just say something. If you have hard spheres, so let's say billiard balls, and you put them into an arrangement or into a box, then for a certain volume fraction, you know, typically larger around about 50%, suddenly these disordered balls that have no incentive to form an ordered structures will arrange into an ordered lattice simply because in this case the system has more microstates as compared to this system. And that is simply because you increase vibrational decrease of freedom. So these spheres here can vibrate much better than these ones here because they're all in contact. And this raises the overall entropy of this state higher than this state. And this is why we observe this phase transition. Okay, just as a short side note. And now what we want to do is go back to this mixing phenomena. And now we already know how we can count this, just to show you again these theta conditions that I just had on the blackboard, maybe in a little bit nicer drawn. And what we want to do now is apply Boltzmann's equation to count the entropy first. This will give us the entropy of mixing. And once we have this, we will also find an expression again for the enthalpy of mixing. And this then will give us the free energy of mixing. Okay, so let's start. So to do this, we simply assume that delta H is zero, and then that delta G is only determined by, okay, and then later we factor in the entropy, the enthalpy. So now we know from Boltzmann's equation that we have delta S, or S is K ln omega, so delta S will be KB, the Boltzmann constant, it's just a constant that we don't need to bother about too much. And this would be ln omega 1, 2 minus ln omega 1 plus ln omega 2. So this is simply Boltzmann equation applied to the entropy of mixing, and we see that now what we need to do is find an expression for omega 1, 2, which is the numbers of microstates after mixing, and expressions for the numbers of microstates before mixing. Microstates after mixing. And these ones are the microstates before mixing. So now let's first make our life simple, and we don't consider polymers, but small molecules, monomers, for example, solvent molecules. Okay? And then we will afterwards see what changes if we go to polymers. And what we're going to do, or the idea behind all this, is the so-called Flory-Huggins lattice model. So Flory and Huggins were the inventors, or they derived these equations that we're now going to re-derive or re-evaluate. And lattice model is because of one assumption that we're doing. So this Flory-Huggins theory, that's fairly celebrated not only in polymer science, but I think in thermodynamics or physical chemistry in general, actually starts with a very bad assumption. Now we're looking at free energy of mixing, so a system that contains two liquids, and we mix them together. And now what Flory and Huggins did is, as a very first step, they assign these different molecules lattices. So we have material 1 and 1 molecules A, and let's say they are all black points. And then we have N2 molecules B, and they are all white. So this is their picture of two different solutions of molecules, and you see it's a very bad approximation. We all know that molecules in liquid state are not ordered, so the assumption of a lattice is at least dangerous, and there's of course no order. But it doesn't really matter. What this lattice just does is to give us a way on how to, or a simplification for counting. Of course, in reality, it doesn't really matter whether this is in a perfect lattice, in a perfect crystalline lattice, or if it just has average numbers of neighbors that move around. In total, there's a certain number of molecules A and a certain number of molecules B, and they need to be distributed in space. And this is simply what this lattice does. So what we're going to ask us, what happens if we mix these two together? Okay, and of course, if we have now in this case 9 molecules A and 9 molecules B, if we mix them together, overall, our lattice now has twice the amount of sites, and this would be 18. So here is N1 plus N2. So now our task will be to count microstates. Put this maybe up here. And again, microstates are states that you can distinguish on a small level. Now, so how many ways we have to manipulate in a system so that it adopts a slightly different configuration. Now, if we assume that all molecules A and all molecules B are the same, which is true for all molecules. Now, if you have water molecules, you cannot distinguish one water molecule from the other water molecule. And now the numbers of microstates we can imagine as I ask you all to go out or to switch off the camera or whatever. And now I'm taking one of these molecules out and changing its position with a different molecule. And then when you come back in or switch back on your cameras, then the question to ask is whether or not you see that I manipulated anything. And clearly, for mixture or for identical molecules A and B, I cannot manipulate anything here. Whatever I do here, next time you look at it, it looks exactly the same, right? Because it's just black balls in a black lattice. So everything looks perfectly identical. So that means for small molecules, omega 1, well, let's put it this way, N1 and N2 are indistinguishable. And that means omega 1 and omega 2 are both 1. There's just a single microstate that describes this situation. And this means that ln omega and ln omega 2 is 0. And this in turn now means that the entropy of mixing up here is only determined by the numbers of microstates after mixing. So we can already say here omega 1 is 1. Omega 2 is also 1. So our whole task now simplifies in asking ourselves how many possible combinations I have to place N1 molecules A and N2 molecules B into a lattice of N1 and N2 positions. And now for some of you this may sound familiar. If you had combinatorial mathematics maybe at school or saw this somewhere else. If not, let me briefly walk you through how we do this. So we can compute omega 1, 2 by first asking how many possibilities I have to place the very first white ball or black ball here in the lattice. So I can clearly place it here, I can place it here, 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 and so on and so forth until here. And since our lattice has N1 plus N2 positions, for the very first ball I have N1 plus N2 possibilities. Then I take the second one, let's say a white one, and I place it either here, or there, or there, or there, and there. And clearly all the lattice is available for me except for the first one. So what is left is N1 plus N2 minus 1. Oops. Then I take the third one, let's say a black one again. And of course I can put it here and here and here and here in all the lattice positions except these two. So what I have left is N1 plus N2 minus 2. And now I continue to do this until I pick the very last one. And of course, the very last one that is over only has a single space here where I can put it because the lattice is already full with all the other molecules. So times 1. And a more convenient way of writing such a product is a faculty. So this we describe as N1 plus N2 faculty. Now we would be at the end of our calculation here if we could distinguish all these different molecules 1 and 2. But again, if I now place them in the lattice, let me just place some more. And so on and so forth. once we have all these microstates, again we have this problem that we cannot distinguish whether this molecule and this molecule change places, or whether this molecule and this molecule change places. So since all of the black ones and all of the white ones are not distinguishable, we are double counting a lot of states, because we don't know, or it doesn't matter whether the first one was positioned here, or the second one was positioned here, or the last one of the black ones was positioned here. And in our equation here, these states are all counted. And in order to account for this, non-distinguishability, we need to divide by n1 faculty times n2 faculty. So this kind of avoids, or this takes out these double countings, because we cannot distinguish one from two. Okay, so now we're in business, and now I can also swap the blackboards. We have a possibility to compute the entropy, as you see here. And we also know that now delta S is K times ln n1 plus n2 faculty divided by n1 faculty times n2 faculty. Factorial, it's not faculty, it's factorial in English. So n1 factorial times n2 factorial. Fakultät is the German word for that. Okay, so now our problem is that these factorials are not easily resolved in this logarithm. So it's not easy to get an equation out of such an expression. The next thing we need to do, we rely on mathematicians that actually solved such problems for us, and we apply Stirling's approximation. So let me just put this here. And that simply says that we can approximate the logarithm of a factorial as n times ln n minus n. Okay, now we apply this, and we simply do exactly this Stirling's approximation for this formula here. So we get delta S is K times n1 plus n2 ln n1 plus n2 minus n1 plus n2. So this would be the first expression here, the numerator, and we also have this denominator, which is n1 factorial and n2 factorial. So these come in as minus n1 ln n1, and then minus times minus is plus, so plus n1, and similarly n minus n2 ln n2 plus n2. Okay, and now we can clean up the entire thing a little bit, and we see that minus n1 plus n1 goes out of the equation, minus n2 plus n2 also goes out of the equation, and that means that we only left with these three terms here. And now what I'm also going to do is I will take out the minus sign. So minus k, and then this one becomes negative, this one becomes positive, n1 ln n1 plus n2 ln n2 plus n1 plus n2 ln n1 plus n2. And now I separate for terms that contain n1 and terms that contain n2, and I simply do this by multiplying this expression here. And what I'm then left with is delta S, this minus K, times N1, ln N1. This is a minus here. Minus N1 ln N1 plus N2. So I can express this as N1 ln N1 divided by N1 plus N2. Now, because the difference between two logarithms is the same as the quotient within the logarithm. And it can do the same thing for N2. So N2 ln N2 minus N2 ln N1 plus N2 is N2 ln N2 divided by N1 plus N2. Okay, so now this is really a lot of n's in this expression, but you see we have significantly simplified our expression and now only have two terms that describe the entropy of mixing. So the next thing that we realize, or maybe let me clean up some space and then we can do it more accurately. So now we do some more small transformations. First, we realize that N1, which is the numbers of molecules 1, divided by N1 plus N2, which is the total numbers of molecules, is nothing else than the mole fraction X1 of material 1, no, amount of 1 divided by total amount. And of course, this similarly is X2. And then we can also, let me just, for sake of completeness, I'll write it again. So we just do some more small transformations. And then yield delta S. And again, it's always Sm, the entropy of mixing, is minus K times N1 ln X1 mole fractions. Let me also write this down here so that we don't forget it. N1 ln X1 plus N2 ln X2. And the next thing is we convert it into mole properties and not molecular properties. So what we use is we replace K by R, and R is the gas constant. And this is Avogadro's number. So we multiply everything by Avogadro's numbers, and then K becomes R because we're going from single molecules or single particles to moles of particles, which is then R. So delta Sm is then minus R, and now I need to divide by Na. So this would be N1 times Na is small n1, which is now the numbers of moles and not the numbers of molecules, ln x1 plus, sorry, N2 ln X2. And now we realize that it's often better to normalize this by the total system size. So N0 is the numbers of moles of material totally in our mixture. And this would then be minus R times N1 divided by N0 ln X1 plus N2 divided by N0 ln X2. And now the reason why I'm doing all this is first of all because it makes thermodynamic sense, no, to normalize this by its system size. But secondly, now we have expressions where we have N1 total numbers of molecules. 1 divided by N0, which is the numbers of molecules. And we can now, this, as you see, this is again the mole fraction. And what we assume now is that material 1 and 2 have equal volumes. And this is, I would say, justified because both of them are small molecules and they are in first approximation the similar size, which is also important because our lattice model, which I just deleted, accounts for the fact that we can change the positions of these two without changing anything. So this kind of accounts for equal volumes as well. So that we have phi1, which is the volume fraction, is volume of material 1 divided by V total. And if they have the same volumes, then phi1 is the same as x1 and phi2 is the same as x2. So now why we're doing this is because now we get an expression delta Sm divided by N0 is minus R times phi1 So we get this somewhat symmetric expression for our entropy of mixing of two monomers. So you see, this is now, after all these calculations, what comes out of this. And now let's have a quick look at what this means. We recall that the free energy in this in our system, if we exclude enthalpy, is simply delta G is minus T delta S. And we want the free energy to be negative in order to for things to mix. So now let's look at this expression. We have the entropy here. The whole expression is negative. So anything that's on the right-hand side is negative. R is the gas constant, which is a number. So this number is positive. And then we have phi1 and phi2. And both of these phis are volume fractions, so volume of one species divided by the volume of the other species. And a volume fraction, by definition, runs between 0 and 1. So we have a positive small number between 0 and 1 here and here. And both of these are multiplied by the natural logarithm of the same positive number between 0 and 1. And now what we know is that the logarithm of a number that is smaller than 1 is negative. So this term here will become negative. This term here is also negative. Multiplied by a positive number remains negative. Multiplied by a positive number remains negative. Multiplied by R remains negative. Multiplied by minus 1 is positive. So we see that delta S is always larger than 0. And this verifies our assumption that the entropy of mixing is always positive and favors mixing. Oh, a positive number here means a negative delta G, and this favors mixing. Okay, so take home message: for this entire chapter, if you want, is that the entropy of mixing is always in favor of the mixing process. Okay, so now what we want to actually do is understand what changes for polymers. And before doing this, let me clear up some space. And you can already think about how we, what we need to change in our models to account for the one material being a polymer. So again, keep in mind that all this is for small molecules. Now we will see what happens if we change to polymers. So again, we start with exactly the same idea and try to put molecules 1 and molecules 2 from two separate lattices in one combined lattice. But the problem is, of course, a polymer is much, much larger than a monomer. And this means, of course, it's completely not justified to put a polymer into a single lattice position. Because it's just too big. So this approximation that they have the same volumes, material 1 and 2, is absolutely not justified for this solution or for this polymer material. But our solution can be, we take a polymer for what it is. It is just a chain of interconnected monomers. And each of these monomers will fit into one lattice position. And the monomers, again, we can assume to have equal volume to the solvent or to the second monomer, and so on. So our lattice will now look as follows. We have again in our example, we say N1 is a monomer or a solvent, so a small molecule. And N2 is a polymer. So now what we do is, again, we make up our lattice. So this is N1. White solvent molecules, and we mix it with N2 polymers. And each of these polymers is a chain of interconnected monomers. So the lattice, the overall lattice positions will be, let me put this in a different color because it's important, x times N2, and x is the number of monomers. Okay, so in our words, this would be the degree of polymerization, X. So now we can put our polymer here in our lattice. And again, we need to make sure that these are interconnected. So let's just, for the sake of it, let's just use two polymers. And put them in here. And then after the mixing process, we again have a lattice that is composed of these two individual lattices. And the total numbers of positions would be n1 plus x n2. So now what we need to do is we will need to distribute our monomers and our polymers. So now we can, before really going into the math of it, we can already from this picture understand what is going on. So firstly, for the monomers, in this case here, if I change something, as before, you will not see a difference because all of these monomers look alike. So we already know that omega 1 is 1. There's only one position, or ln omega 1 is 0, so we don't need to count these numbers of states for our entropy. So the first important point, if we now look at the polymer material before mixing, we realize something surprising. Now, if you now go out of your room or switch off your camera and I manipulate the system here, you will be able to see it because the polymer chains are connected. So there's more than one possibility on how I can place these polymers here. Now I can very simply, instead of having this chain run like this, I could have it, let's say, run like this. And instead of this one curling up this way, I could have it curl up this way. And of course, make up your own drawings, but there's multiple ways on how I can arrange this chain. So I could also have it start here and start here and so on and so forth. So clearly, if I manipulate this system and you go out and come back in, you will detect that I did something. And this is a clear sign that, again, omega 2 is larger than 1. And keep in mind, for the entropy of mixing, these factors are what is subtracted for the entropy of mixing. Now this goes into this minus ln omega 1 minus ln omega 2 term. So this is bad for the entropy of mixing. And secondly, do we have it somewhere? No. And secondly, if I now place these different materials here, again, for the small molecules, I can place them however I want. I pick up one, put it here, and I have n1 plus xn2 possibilities. I pick up the second, I put it here, 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 or here. So I have n1 plus xn2 minus 1 positions, and so on and so forth. But if I pick out a polymer, let's say I pick out this one, what I get is the entire chain because it's connected. And if I start to place the chain, let's say randomly here, then for the second monomer in this polymer, I don't have all these possibilities. I cannot put this one now here or here or here. I can only put it right next to the first one. So if I add one, in our case, I only have four possibilities for the second one. I can put it here, 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 or here, but not anywhere else. And for this one, again, I only have the nearest neighbors where I can put it. And likewise for the fourth one, and so on and so forth. So putting a polymer of interconnected chains into the lattice gives us less microstates after mixing compared to small molecules. So delta omega 1,2 for polymers is smaller, omega 1,2 for small molecules. And this is, in a nutshell, already the key finding of everything we're going to do afterwards. You see it here already. Since delta S, or delta S is K ln omega 1, 2 minus ln omega 1 minus ln omega 2. You see that S will become smaller if this one goes down or if this one goes up. And in the case of polymers, both of these things are fulfilled. So it's already two mechanisms why the entropy of mixing, delta S here, will become smaller for polymers. No, because you weaken the first term and you strengthen the term before mixing. Okay, so now we can also put this into numbers. So maybe because it's so important, let me just put it here again. Qualitative. Omega 1 is 1, omega 2 is larger than 1, and this means that delta S will go down, and omega 1, 2 for polymers is smaller than omega 1, 2 for small molecules, and this also means that delta S goes down. Okay, so this is, in simple words, what I already discussed. And now if we want to quantify, we need to go back into our entropy of mixing formula. So delta S is S1, 2 minus S1 minus S2. And we already saw that we can convert this into these logarithms. We know that S1 doesn't play a role because omega 1 is 1. So this will be k times ln omega 1, 2. But now, in the case of polymers, we need to divide by omega 2 since it is larger than 1. Okay, so this is kind of the thing to solve. So again, we need to count omega 1, 2 and omega 2. And if we can do this, oops, 2, then we get delta S complete. Now the problem is that this is a bit cumbersome. Now you cannot do the simple statistics that we did before, simply because the polymer chains are connected, as you've seen here. So for each step you place a polymer, you need to kind of factor in how many positions you have and then count this up. And this makes it mathematically a little bit more inconvenient. So what I'm going to do now is give you a shortcut on how we can simplify this and rationalize what is how the formula will evolve. So our shortcut is that we know that polymers are very large, so they occupy more volume. And how we factored this in was that we, instead of using N2 in the formula for our volume fractions, we actually should use X times N2. And again, X being the degree of polymerization. So we need to consider this transformation . This difference here, that N2 in terms of volume should actually be X times N2, we need to consider this in our expression for the volume fractions, because otherwise we will very strongly miscount the amount of polymers in the system. Consider difference in . Okay, so now we simply go back to our initial Flory-Huggins equation. delta Sm equals minus k times n1 ln n1 plus n2 times ln n2 divided by n1 plus n2. And now I modify this equation as I said before. So instead of using n2, I use xn2. And we saw that these expressions will become the expression for the volume fractions. Now because we divide this here. So we add an x here, we add an x here, and we add an x here. And now we set our volume fractions right. Because now what we see is that here we account for the larger numbers of lattice positions occupied by the polymer chain, where this x and 2 in the total chains, similarly here. And here we also account for the larger numbers of monomers that occupy the lattice fractions as compared to what we would expect from the numbers of polymers. Here's just the numbers of polymers, so n2 is absolutely okay. So now we do exactly the same thing as before. First we convert to mole properties. So we replace k by na. This will give us small n1 here, so the mole fractions. So molar quantities. And then second, we will use the volume fractions. Phi 1 is n1 divided by n1 plus x n2. So this one here, and phi 2 is x n2 divided by n1 plus x n2. So now I clear up some space again. And we can now put up the Flory-Huggins equation for polymer solvent mixtures. And we see that we get delta S. So I converted it into molar quantities. So we have minus R. And then we have n1 ln phi 1 plus n2 ln phi 2. And now you will be surprised, it looks exactly the same as the expression for the small molecules. But now we convert to, or we divide by n0. And now we realize, so convert to n0, and now again, as before, I approximate n1 divided by n0 as phi 1. So the mole fraction that appears here, I convert into the volume fraction. And again, this is justified because our lattice assumes that all these individual small molecules have the same volume. And now here I have a problem, because now n1 divided by n0 is not equal phi 2. But phi 2 is much smaller. And the difference is that I need to factor in this degree of polymerization. So again, just to show you, N2 divided by N0 is not equal phi 2, but phi 2, sorry, but phi 2 is x N2 divided by N0. So in order to account for this difference in volume, I put in this x here. And this is exactly what makes the difference. So here polymer is material 2. Boy. The solvent is material 1. And now we can evaluate what is going, how this changes. So we see that solvent 1 creates an expression where phi 1 is smaller than 1, so this becomes negative, and this makes the expression positive. So promotes mixing, or if you want, contributes positively to the entropy of mixing. Now here, this is the polymer. As material 2. And this polymer also creates like a negative volume fraction because phi 2 is definitely between 1 and 0. But because you divide this by x, it will be close to 0. And this will be close to 0 because x is large. And now because you divide by a large number, you can neglect this term, and it does not really contribute to the entropy of mixing. So it only gives a very small contribution. Now you see overall, if you compare monomer and polymer, you see that monomer mixtures and monomer polymer mixtures, you see that the entropy of mixing goes down. So they do not mix so well. And if we now do a polymer-polymer system, we can do exactly the same as we have done before, but now material 1 is also a polymer. So everything that applies for material 2, now we need to apply for material 1 as well. And then what comes out? Comes out delta Sm divided by N0 is minus R phi 1 divided by x ln phi 1 plus phi 2 divided by x ln phi 2. And this is now the entropy of mixing for two polymers. And what you see is, again, the term will become positive because we have two negative values here and we multiply by minus 1, but we divide by, strictly speaking, this would be x1 and this would be x2. We divide by a large number, the degree of polymerization. Now keep in mind there is hundreds, thousands, maybe 10,000 of monomers linked together in this chain. So this will severely weaken the first expression. This one will severely weaken the second expression. And that means that overall the contribution of entropy is much, much lower. Okay, so what we learn from this is that the entropy of mixing for small molecules is much larger compared to the entropy of mixing for mixtures of polymer and solvent, and the entropy of mixing for two polymers is even lower. And here you directly see why. First of all, polymers do not dissolve as well as small molecules, and two polymers mix much, much worse compared to two mixtures of monomers. Okay, this is now in black and white what we assumed beforehand, and this is the reason why polymers phase separate. Okay, so now this explains the entropy of mixing, and this is pretty much the important factor that differentiates between polymers and monomers. For the sake of completeness, I just want to briefly discuss the role of entropy. so that we have the complete expression for the free energy of mixing. And I apologize if this takes a little bit longer. This is of course something we will factor in the rest of the lecture, which will then be a little bit shorter. Let me just clean up the blackboard again, and maybe just for the sake of completeness, write again here. Delta S mixing small, larger, delta S mixing small polymer, and this is again larger as the delta S M polymer. Okay, so this is the central finding here. Good. And now let's clear up the blackboard once more. Good, now some last words to the enthalpy of mixing. And in order to do this, so this is delta H, and delta H relates to the interactions between monomers of the same species and monomers of the different species, or polymer segments and monomer segments, and so forth. So it relates to interactions. So now you will see that we can also count these interactions. So our strategy is we first see changes for a pair, so we compute what changes for if monomer 1 is now in neighborhood of monomer 2 and not monomer 1, and then we sum up all these contexts, over all contexts. And this sum then will give us the complete enthalpy of mixing when we change these interactions. So in short, what we're going to do is we have a pair of one contact. We need to separate this. And we pay a price for this because the molecules interact in an attractive fashion, for example, via van der Waals forces. And this is what we lose here. And we also need to sum up two polymers or two polymer segments in our chain. And we pay the price that we lose these attractive interactions between these two polymer segments. But now we put them together, and then what we get is pairs of monomer. Maybe we make this white here to distinguish a bit better. And solvent. And we get two of these, no, because we have altogether four molecules. And what we gain is the enthalpy of this mixed pair. So delta H on this at this pair level, delta H is H 1, 2, which is this one here, minus 1 half H 1, 1 plus H 1, 2, 1, 2, 2. Okay, so this is what changes for at this molecular level. And now we need to sum up, or we need to find an expression for the total amount of contacts from a solvent and a polymer or two polymers. So how do we do this? Total number of contacts. We assign as capital P, 1, 2, and then we get our delta Hm, enthalpy of mixing, by multiplying P, 1, 2 times delta H of mixing. So times this expression here, delta Hm. Okay, so now we need to count P, 1, 2. And we take our lattice model. So each polymer chain has x segments. And of these segments, so we have a polymer chain with ones here, and this is number is x. And in the lattice, each of these polymer segments and so on has, if z is the total number of contacts, two are already occupied, the rest is free. C minus 2 empty neighbor positions. So in the example here, x minus 2 would be 2. Now this position is free and this position is free for this segment. This one is occupied and this one is occupied by the chain. This is why we need to subtract 2. So now the total, to be very precise, the total numbers of sites is C minus 2 times X plus 2 sites available. Why? X is the number of polymer segments. Each has C minus 2 empty sites. And at both ends, I have one more because here's an empty one, and here's an empty one as well. But of course, x is very large, so we can ignore the 2. And in very good approximation, this is c minus 2 times x. Okay, so now we are almost finished. The total number of sites. That's around the polymer. So that are available for these contacts is P12 we have N2 polymer chains. Each of these polymer chains has Z minus 2 times X contacts. Our total numbers of sites is this one, and now what we do is total numbers of contacts. So this is numbers of sites and now what we assume is that the numbers of contacts 1, 2 here. So how many mixed contacts we have must be related to the amount of material 1 and material 2 that is in there. So we have N2 blah 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 chains. So this is all sites in the neighborhood of N2. And now we multiply by phi 1 and say on average these sites are occupied with a likelihood phi 1 by molecule 1 and by phi 2 with molecule 2. Because the more volume of phi 1 I add, the more molecules of material 1 I have, and this gives me more mixed contacts. Okay, this assumption is known as a mean field theory. So sites are occupied according to number ratio of 1. So this means we do not take into account that maybe the polymer is more preferably surrounded by solvents, or that the solvent does not like to surround the polymer. On average, if we have 8 out of 10 molecules in there, or 8 out of 10, if the volume fraction here is 0.8, so 8 out of 10 molecules or segments are 1, then we will have more mixed contacts as compared to if this was smaller. Okay, I think this makes sense. So now we can factor this in. Total numbers of contacts is N2C minus 2 times X times phi 1. And now we replace phi 1 directly by N1 over N total. And then we can also convert this as saying this is the same as N1C minus 2 times phi 2, because phi 2 is N2 times X divided by N total. Okay, so now we have replaced the numbers of polymers and the degree of polymerization by the numbers of monomers here. And then we get an expression for delta HM, which is C minus 2 times N1 times phi 2 times delta H 1, 2, or delta H mixing. Now these contacts here. And this can now be computed. Now we know the numbers of monomer molecules, we know the volume fraction here. What we don't know so well is how the lattice actually looks like, or how many positions we have on average, and how the interactions of the single materials play out. So what we now do is, let me just call it get rid of terms we cannot measure or we cannot access directly. And this is this one and this one. And we define a property that is known as chi, and this is the Flory-Huggins interaction parameter. And this chi is C minus 2 delta H M divided by KT. So this is everything that we know from the molecular properties, now the change in enthalpy over contact and the numbers of contacts around, surrounding this is encoded in this parameter. And the good thing is that this parameter we can determine experimentally. And this is what I will show you next week, how we can do this. So, and with this, we're then at the end of today's lecture. We now know that delta Hm is kT N1 phi 2 times chi, or we can also put this in molar properties, which would then be RT N1 phi 2 times x. And then we can find an expression for delta g, which is delta h minus t delta s. And this would be rt times this one, and times the term for the entropy, which I showed you before. So RT N1 ln phi 1 plus N2 ln phi 2 plus N1 phi 2 chi. So this is delta H. And this here is related to delta S. And now we can do the same thing that we did before. We divide by N0 and replace by the volume fractions. Delta G divided by N0. And this is then RT, or KT if you want, phi 1 divided by X ln phi 1 plus phi 2 divided by x ln phi 2 plus phi 1 phi 2 chi. And now after all this math, we finally have derived an expression for the free energy of mixing of two polymers. And again, to be precise, this should be properly indexed. So what do we see? The free energy of mixing for polymers, as we discussed, is lower as compared to small molecules because the entropy terms are very significantly weakened, and the free energy of mixing of polymers is then mostly determined by this enthalpy term. So if you want, it doesn't get any support from the free entropy of mixing, and this enthalpy term is determined by this Flory-Huggins interaction parameters. So mostly polymers do not mix unless really this interaction parameter becomes very small. So the interaction is favorable. See, very small means, or negative means, they like to mix here. Then the system promotes mixing. If not, it does not. So in total summary, polymers really mix worse than monomers, as we can see from these equations by these x1 and x2. And with this, we are at the end of the lecture. So you see, we use quite a lot of math. But at the end of the day, we get a fairly symmetric and fairly simple expression for the free energy of mixing. And now we have really a defined and clear answer to why polymers mix less or dissolve worse compared to small molecules. And with this, thank you very much for your attention. Sorry for taking some more time. I'll make up for this next week. And I hope that everybody stays healthy and well. Take care. Goodbye.